Hello, hello.
Front Porch Show.
Away we go.
Front Porch Show.
Hello, hello. Away we go on with the Front Porch Show.
It's Dynamo.
Front Porch Show.
Magnifico.
Front Porch Show.
Dynamo Magnifico on with the Front Porch Show. We'll share a laugh or two. Big smiles from me and you.
Come on, hello, hello,
Front Porch Show.
We're set to go.
Front Porch Show.
Hello, hello, we're set to go on with the
Front Porch Show.
Here's Don,
live from St. Mary's by the Seat of Our Pants Productions, is proud to present the season finale of the Front Porch Show. Starring John Stevens and Bill the Wonder Dog and Kaylee. This is Don Van Galen along with the piano man Frank StGermain, inviting you to join John and his guest, Gail McCauley, crossing guard extraordinaire.
Yeah.
Matthew Corbett from the St. Mary's Library. Mark Oliver from the Rotary Exchange Program. Our special musical guest, the Stonetown Entertainers.
Yeah.
And our regular features, Community Calendar with Miss Lauren Eady. And a special edition of Alternate Facts, all today in the season finale of the Front Porch Show.
We'll share a laugh or two.
Great.
Big smiles for me and you.
And the Pook Toque guys. Front Porch Show!
We're set to go!
Front Porch Show!
Hello, hello, we're set to go on with the Front Porch Show!
And now, here's John!
There we go. I put on a tie for you this week. Hope Rosemary's watching.
It's about time!
Yeah, okay, well, welcome again to the most beautiful small town in Canada, maybe the whole world, for the final Front Porch Show of the summer. And of course, as we said before, the Christmas show is going to be Sunday, November 25th. And Kaylee, hello, where did Bill go? Bill's gone already.
Right behind the table.
Oh. Okay, hello, Bill.
There's
Roberta here. Roberta, put up your hands, Jeff. There we go, there's Roberta way back there. Roberta, I'd like to thank everybody. A couple of weeks, everybody was very kind for her, and she's back here watching the Front Porch Show, healthy and happy. She was literally a showstopper a couple of weeks ago. But she says thanks to everybody. Notice, by the way, the fancy curtains we have, courtesy of McBride's Rentals in Rannoch. And how do you like my Salvation Army shirt this week? They're getting better. They're looking for me every week. Unfortunately, this is the last show, so I won't be available till Christmas. They're thinking of, I'm thinking of having a modeling job, though. What do you think? We're okay?
Need a little work,
okay.
There, Johnny.
How many are here for the first time? Put up your hands. Wow. Wonderful. Okay. And out of towner. Who's from out of town? Where are you from?
London.
Ouch. Newmarket. Wow.
Whoa. Calgary.
Calgary. Who's Calgary? Stand up. I want to see the Calgary. Okay. We got any of those.
Let's hear a Calgary. Yeehaw.
Yeehaw.
Okay. We should add flapjacks for you. Okay. Now we go back to our internet viewers. Rich Miller, as usual, from Glendore, although he's not watching live today. He sent us a note. He's visiting with family. But he's still on the job, and he's still trying to get who here?
Ellen.
And that's our goal for Christmas. We're not going to give up on it. If it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. But we're going to try our best. Not because we want Ellen to do something for us, but we want to do something for Ellen. We really believe this town has something to give her, because she's given in such a kind way to so many other people. We don't want anything from her, but we want her to experience the magic of this small town. Tony Scatella from Hamilton, Ann and David Winkler-Morey from Minneapolis, St. Paul. I know Stephen, Dahlia, Hannah, and Ella are watching right now. Mike Murray from Picton. Now, here's one. I've never heard of this place. Greg Margeson from Detour Gold. Does anybody know where Detour Gold is? It's in Ontario, and it's 2 hours north of Cochrane. So this guy's in a very interesting place. Ian Wade from, listen to this one, Erbil, Iraq. And we have our regular Istanbul crowd, Kubra Erdogan, Jada Beryl, and Savash Esatoglu. There we go. If you can say that three times, you're good. Leave a comment on our live broadcast right now if you want, and we will try to mention you during the show.
Hey, John!
Oh, Gretchen,
John,
come on up
John,
here. Come up, yeah.
John!
Oops, watch out for the dogs. Okay, what's going on? Oh, you're a bit lower than I am. There we go.
How was that?
Yes, what's going on?
I'm singing in a concert.
What concert?
Come to the fair. I know in St. Mary's we don't have a fall fair anymore, but we thought that fair might be appropriate for the fall. So the choir is London Pro Musica, with which I sing, and if any of you are familiar, well, thank you. If any of you are familiar with Mary Jane Osborne, she also has been a member of this choir. And if you look at the pictures that you might have seen around, you look like we're very, very staid, but we're not. This concert is fair-lated, fair-themed. All the music has to do with fairs, like Come to the Fair, and Widdicombe Fair, and Spinning Wheel, and Scarborough Fair, and food, glorious food, just like here. So the tickets are available all over town. I have some here with me tonight. Arlene Callender has some here tonight. They are $20 a piece. The tickets are for a concert on September the 30th, which is a Sunday afternoon at 4 p.m. And the tickets are available at Flower Shop and More or at the United Church office. It will be at the United Church. And thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Thank you, Gretchen. Is Ashley here? No. Okay. Well, we have our first guest.
Come to the fair. Don and John will be there.
I'll be there.
I won't wear no underwear.
Not the pink one.
But John and Don and Frank will be there.
You just made that up, right?
I did.
Yeah,
I'm shocked.
How do I know? Hey, he's amazing.
So
he just makes these songs up. Let's hear it from Frank StGermain, our gentleman. Well, for our first guest, get rid of this. There we go. If you drive along James Street after school, you've seen her waving at you. Here she is, Gail McCauley.
Cross me, baby.
You're a hero.
Thank you.
How long have you been a crossing guard?
It's going into my third year.
Right. And when did you start waving at cars?
Right from the beginning.
Why do you do it?
Just to wish him a good day.
Okay. What do you enjoy most about the job?
Waiting. Okay. And the kids. And the kids, yes.
Okay.
And the kids.
How do you get through the cold winters?
Oh, sometimes it's really bad.
Yeah.
But we do it.
Do Pook Toque products help you?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
Yes.
Pook, good guys, where are you? You help her through the winter. Help me make it through the winter, not night.
Help me make it
through. Okay. The town is looking for more crossing guards. Why would you recommend it?
Because it's a rewarding situation to be in. It's the kids are excellent. I have some of my kids here tonight, mm-hmm. and I just love it.
And one day, if you go long enough, you're going to be looking after their kids.
Exactly. I can watch them grow up.
Now, do you wave at absolutely everybody?
Everybody.
No, I know one person who, I snuck by you once.
I know it was you. It was you. I knew it was you.
Okay, Don's going to come on here because Don is going to learn, because Don is not going to be our town councilor anymore, so he needs a new job. And what do you say this one's going to, how the pay is going to be for this one?
Well, the pay is going to be much better, I guarantee it.
And the people you're working with?
I'm going to get benefits and a pension. And all the other stuff you don't get as a counselor.
Okay, but Don has to first learn how to be a crossing guard.
Yeah, this
so
is going
to
be tough.
So, Gail, you have to give him the instructions.
Okay. You go up, you stand there, and you tell the kids to stay on the sidewalk.
Okay, I'm crossing.
Stay right there, man.
I'm crossing.
You're gonna cross?
Yeah. Okay. Can I cross now?
Face the audience, please. There we go.
Wow. Now,
I'm driving by. You got to wave at me.
Go ahead.
You got to wave at me. I'm driving by.
Okay, Don. Don, you try it now. Come on over here.
Okay.
It's going to take some practice.
What's that?
It's going to take some practice for Don.
How long did it take you to learn?
I got it quite fast.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we got about 30 seconds. Is it possible?
Are you quick on it?
No.
No?
No. I'm just going to say.
Will you try it?
All right.
Okay, Don.
Okay.
Well, I like to
stay right there, little Joe.
Cross.
Stay right there. Don't cross.
Don't cross. There might be a car coming.
Okay. Doesn't look like any cars are coming, so. There you go.
Where's the cars?
Oh, I got to go back for my lunch at Subway.
Okay. There's the car going. There's the car.
Okay, everybody, wave.
Wave at the car.
Wave,
everybody. Well, How'd I do? All right, terrific. So you're going to give me a recommendation to Brent?
Yes, I'll go to the town hall and tell Tricia.
All right, terrific.
Yes.
Okay, Gail.
Tell him December 1st. I need a new job.
Okay.
Well, you've given a lot of people a lot of joy in St. Mary's. Thank you for joining us, Gail McCauley.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, I think we have Don on again, and he's going to do alternate facts. All right, I absolutely had to have something special for you for this week for alternate facts. I need my guests to join me. Come on down, fabulous prizes. I have a guest alternate facts storyteller, and you would happen to be...
I'm your kid.
I think I gave you a name when you were born.
My name is Adeline.
Thank you, Adeline. And you have an alternate fact story about St. Mary's for us. And these two lovely people are?
Dan
and?
Teresa.
Dan and Teresa. Teresa, can you come back here so you're not standing in front of Dan? He's so short, you'd never see him. Anyway, so we're going to give you the story, and you're going to determine whether or not it is true or an alternate fact for fabulous prizes courtesy of St. Mary's Ford. So, Adeline, please give us the story this week.
The Faculty of Medicine at the Western University of London, Ontario, was founded in 1881. The Schulich School of Medicine and Dentistry, as it is called today, is one of the most recognized medical programs in the country. In the late 1800s, cadavers, or the bodies in which medical students used to practice their medical studies, were in very short supply. Cadavers were not supplied by the institutions, so most of the time students were left to their own devices. In fact, a very common method to obtain a cadaver was to go to your local graveyard and dig up a fresh corpse. It's true, or is it? While this was and is still a crime, many medical students performed this grisly act, and even if they were caught, most were usually just given a slap on the wrist. Members of the public were very sympathetic to their cause. They just didn't want them digging up and practicing on their Aunt Sally, okay? As a means to protect the recently buried, dearly departed, officials in London began to step up their security at the local graveyards. So, two medical students decided to travel to St. Mary's to see if they would have more luck finding a cadaver without issue. And they did just that. They managed to unearth a freshly buried body in town, and they began to head back to London. However, they decided to stop at an inn on the way home to get a bottle of whiskey and calm their nerves a little bit. It was their first time stealing a body, after all. As they went into the inn, they didn't see a man by the name of Jack Henderson approach their carriage, but he knew exactly what these two were doing, so he decided to take this opportunity to teach the two a little lesson. So he took the body down from their carriage, and he put it in his own. He then removed the long coat and hat they had disguised upon the body, and he put it upon himself. He climbed into their carriage, and he sat down and sat very quietly. The two men returned from the inn not long afterwards, didn't notice anything was any different. The first man popped open the bottle of whiskey, had a drink. The second man took the bottle, had a drink as well. And then he thought it would be hilarious to offer their third friend a drink. When the bottle was brought to Jack's lips, he grabbed the bottle, thanked the man, and he had a drink. And that's when the two of them dashed out of the carriage into either direction and were later captured by the authorities. So
what we want to know, is this a true story of St. Mary's, or is this in fact an alternate fact?
Alternate
fact. Now, why would you distrust my daughter so? One look at me and said, I don't even have to answer that question.
I would say it's true.
You say it's true. And why would you say it's true, sir?
It looks like it's on the internet. It must be true.
Absolutely. When you see it on the internet, it must be true. It must be true. Yeah. All right, ladies and gentlemen, time for you to register your opinion. What do you think? True or alternate fact?
True!
Sound like majority was true. But I really don't know, and perhaps our storyteller here can reveal the answer.
This did not happen in St. Mary's. So it is an alternate fact, but this whole story did take place in Kingston, Ontario, which is where I live. And you can hear this tale in its whole entirety if you come to the Haunted Walk of Kingston, which I also work at. And we have some fabulous ghost passes for the winners today to come on our tours. We're also found in Ottawa and Toronto and Kingston. And we always all end our tours by saying sweet dreams to everybody. So remember that story when you're falling asleep tonight, okay?
So it's an alternate fact for St. Mary's, but it's true that it actually happened in Kingston. So we're not going to split ears. You're both going to be winners today. So we're giving you a choice of one of these gentlemen first here. There we go.
You give me the smaller one.
Oh, okay. Let's not. Okay. There we go. You might have to share with someone else then at that point. And so, as we said, we're also giving away the passes for Haunted Walk in Kingston and Toronto. So,
Ottawa.
So you'll get those from Addie later.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. And that's our episode of Alternate Facts for the final season. Thank you. Final show.
I was working in the lab late one night when my eyes beheld an hideous sight. From the monster from his lap began to rise. Then suddenly, to my surprise, she did the...
What's that?
The monster.
It's a graveyard smash. It cut on with a flash. She did the monster.
Done? There we go.
Have a nice hand for that lovely lady.
Good stuff. Hey,
by the way, with those St. Mary's Ford shirts, you're not allowed to go into St. Mary's Ford and talk to the customers and give them a deal on a car, okay?
In Christville.
I thought of doing that myself, but cash only. Okay, guess we have Lauren Edie from the... wonderful St. Mary's Independent, best small town newspaper in Canada. And Lauren, anything new today?
Not much, but I'm about to read September's events.
You're about to reveal
Yes. What
is going to happen.
In the next month.
By the way, you've been pookified.
Yes.
Pookified. How many people put up your hand?
I got a free
pookified
burger.
Pookified?
Yeah, she's pookified. Put up your hand
how
if you're pookified.
How many people are pookified?
Quite a few people.
There's a few
good
people.
Okay,
fabulous.
Go ahead, Lauren.
Okay, thank you, John. Hello, everyone. Hello. This Wednesday night is this year's final installment of the popular Melodies at the Museum Summer Concert Series, with Corduroy Gordon performing right here in Cadzow Park from 7 to 8 p.m. This weekend marks the beginning of September, so I'll just touch on some of the events coming up for the next month. As we discussed last week on the show, Saturday, September 8th is the annual Evans Touch the Truck event. The St. Mary's Lions will be on hand to serve food that day, with all proceeds going to Evans Touch the Truck. St. Mary's Ford will also be conducting their Drive for Your Community event that day, starting at McLean Taylor's Water Street office, just across from Milt Dunnell Field, or the Flats. The following weekend, Saturday, September 15th, will bring the Ride for Epilepsy at the PRC from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. This kid-friendly event will include Honda's Junior Red Riders, a bouncy castle, face painting, a police canine demonstration, and so much more for the family. All proceeds will benefit Epilepsy Southwestern Ontario. September is all about setting new routines. There are a number of family-oriented events touching on active living and wellness. The annual Terry Fox Run takes place on Sunday, September 16th to raise money for cancer research in the 38th year following Terry's Marathon of Hope. On September 22nd, there will be a health and wellness expo from 10 to 3 p.m. at Thompson Martial Arts, located at 115 Queen Street. A variety of local businesses will be on hand to help you get back on track with your personal health goals. Don't miss out. Keep your running shoes handy for the annual River Road Run, which is coming up on Sunday, September 23rd. This year, the family-friendly run is being organized by the St. Mary's Memorial Hospital Foundation. The River Road has also always been about promoting a healthy, active community, with proceeds of the event helping to sponsor free skates and swims throughout the year. Please visit riverroadrun.ca to sign up. And that's your St. Mary's Community Calendar for the August 26th edition of the Front Porch Show. Have a great week, everyone.
Thank you very much, Lauren. Thanks for the whole team for the information. Okay, our next guest. St. Mary's is proud of its Carnegie Library, but it's much more than what people know. Here's the guy who knows what it's all about, Matthew Corbett. Yeah, that's Matthew Corbett, Mel. Okay, thank you.
Bella, get over here.
Thank you for spending your Sunday evening with us. What got you interested working in libraries?
So, funny story, I didn't even foresee myself going into libraries. I went through as a trained teacher, and I had a couple of really difficult classes, and decided this isn't right for me. And so they stuck me in the school library, and I got some experience in that. And I thought, well, I wasn't ready for the real world when I finished my teaching, so where else can I spend my money for school? And I went and did my master's. Mm.
And where did you go from there then, after the master's?
So I tried to stick it out in London as long as I could, but work was a little difficult to find, so I ended up moving back home. And I was fortunate enough to find a very part-time library job up there.
And where was that?
So I was in Victoria Harbour, and I slowly moved up to be a branch librarian there. And then at the same time, I ended up working in the medium maximum security library in the prison up there.
Yeah. So before we get too far, the St. Mary's Library is currently moving to the Pyramid Recreation Center. Tell us all about that.
Yeah, so this past year, we got approved to have some renovations done on the library. So earlier on, you would have saw that the roof was done. We also got approved for some carpet and paint. And so that's the job that they're doing for the month of September, if all goes well. It's a really big job. What we're doing is we moved a small collection up to the Pyramid Recreation Center on Friday in anticipation for us to be open on Monday, tomorrow. And we are packing up all of our materials, and it's a massive, massive job.
When do you hope to be back in the main library?
So if all goes well, by the end of September, we're hoping to be back in there with fresh paint and brand new carpet.
Wow, that'll be great. Our library, just what a resource for our community. Libraries have changed a lot since my book borrowing days. What kind of services do they offer now that some people may not be aware of?
Yeah, so we still offer the traditional book lending service. Of course, collections have changed quite a bit. So we also offer DVD, multimedia, so magazines, graphic novels, and some audiobooks and CDs. We also have non-traditional items as well. So we rent out fishing rods, and those are pretty popular in the summertime. And this year, you would have saw in the newspaper, we introduced, in partnership with the Pyramid Recreation Center, aquatics passes. So families and people up to four people or five people could come in, get one of these passes and go swimming for free. We also offer a whole bunch of programs for children, youth, and adults, as well as space where people can just study and do homework groups.
I sort of like the one called Tummy Time. I thought that sounds good. I think I might like that. Is that for me?
Well, it's for the younger ones,
okay,
the infants.
That's too bad. Okay. Well, maybe it doesn't involve food, so I'm not really worried about that. But you can get books online. You can learn languages.
Absolutely.
Go do your genealogy.
Yep. So we've got a number of databases. There's 18 databases there. Just over 18 databases that we have access to. And they're all free, as long as you've got a library card.
Say that word again.
It's free.
Free.
Just got to come down, get a library card.
And you know, I just, a lot of people don't realize the number of things. If you don't think it's at the library, go down and ask them, and you'll probably find that maybe it is.
Mm-hmm.
So, because I know, I'm just amazed. You talked about tummy time geared for children. What other things do you have for children?
So we have Tales for Tots. So they do reading, traditional story time reading. And they play with instruments and puppets. We also have Tinker Toddler, so it's a tactile-based play group. And then we also have our summer reading program, which just wrapped up this past week with our barbecue.
Yeah.
Did really well.
What about teens? If I have teenage kids, what can I do with them?
Yeah, so we've got Techie Tuesday, so they can come down, play with some of our technology that we've got. We've also got a writing group. That just kicked off. I think it's their third session that they're doing there. Mm-hmm. And we also offer a volunteer program. So that we had teens come and help us with summer reading this year.
And for the adults?
Yeah, so we've got a multitude of book clubs that they can participate in. We've got Mahjong recently. And then we do pop-up programs every now and again. And the most recent one was tie-dye. So you come down, and it's an after-hours program, and we strategically place this throughout a month.
And one of the things you do at the library, too, is through the Friends of the Library, which is a tremendous support group for the library,
yeah.
Is that you have coffee time for newcomers to St. Mary's.
Yep, so it's the third Thursday, second Thursday, don't quote me on it, second Thursday, where they come down and... anyone can come and sit with some newcomers and introduce them to the community, and we have guest speakers that come down. Yeah, and it's put on by the Friends of the Library. They're tremendous, tremendous help for our library.
And how do you get involved and get access to all this? When I become involved in all these things, how do I get involved?
Yeah, so all you need is, most of our programs are all free. There's donations that we look for at times, but pretty much everything that we offer is free, and to borrow materials from our library, you just have to come down and get a library card.
And you can even borrow, what do you call it, a booklet, an electronic book, an e-book.
Yeah, so we do e-books and audiobooks online, and so you don't even have to leave your house. So you just get you have your library card, and you can download right from the Libby app.
And somebody will say, but I can't operate a computer very well.
And not a problem. So you bring that device down, and we will help you. We'll show you how to... put the books and on those devices.
Now, our tax money obviously goes to the library. If people want to support it in other ways, how can they?
Absolutely. So you can come down and you can just donate right to the library. Our Friends of the Library is tremendous, so you can donate to them, and you can come and help out in these various groups as well.
You've enlightened us tremendously, Matthew. Thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you.
And we're now going to go to commercial. Don, tell us what it's all about. Well, I don't know. What are you doing after the show, John? What am I doing after? We're going to have a party at my house.
Going to have a party at your house?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think, you know, after the end of the summer, people start thinking about parties, you know?
Right.
Maybe not the fall, but they're thinking ahead to Christmas and the holiday season.
And, well, what do you know? The holiday office planning season is just around the corner.
Yeah, we're going to a party. Yeah, we're going to a party.
Oh me, oh my, whatever should I do? La 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 la. Who are you? I'm your fairy godmother. Great, fairy godmother. I could really use your help.
Everyone wants a fun and unique holiday party. I don't know what to do.
My dear, it's so simple. La 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 la.
It's Leanne Gregory Stitt. Can you help me?
Of course I can help you, Christine. We've been making office holiday party magic happen for years with our Taste of Improv party shows and also our I Wanna Laugh shows. We do it for office parties, corporate events, and even stag and does.
Tell me more.
Well, improv comedy is the art of making up scenes on the spot. There's lots of audience participation, even up on stage. And people, when they're at our shows and they want to be part of our show, they put their ticket in the I Wanna Play bucket. And for people that are just a little bit shyer than that, they can just sit back and relax and watch the show.
Fantastic. I'm going to go to the Leanne Gregory Starrett Improv Facebook page and make all the arrangements.
Me too.
What?
Fairy godmothers love office parties too.
Why not? The Rotary Student Exchange Program has been going on for over 50 years in St. Mary's. Mark Oliver is in charge of it in St. Mary's, and he is bringing on the show Abby Leighton, who has just returned from France, Laura Vink, who went to Germany, and Angelica Pierce, who traveled to Croatia, and Jesse Lawson, who hasn't left yet, but she's going to be going to the Czech Republic. Come on on. Yeah, I had them sit down for an obvious reason.
What would that be?
They're taller than you are.
No comment.
Mark, how does the Rotary Student Exchange Program work?
The Rotary Youth Exchange Program is a cultural exchange for students between the ages of 15 and 18. They travel to another country. They live and study there for about 11 months. They're gonna during that time, they'll live with usually about three different host families. They're gonna meet exchange students in that country that are there from all the corners of the world. There's going to be opportunities for them to travel. They will come home pretty much fluent in the language of their host country. And the goals of the program are, we want them to...
Excuse me, I just got to help my dog here. There we go. There we go, Cammie. Okay, she was struggling a bit.
So the goals of the program are... We want them to learn another language, they'll make lifelong friends, and it helps build peace between nations when everyone's friends.
And what makes a student a good candidate?
Well, ideal candidates, like I said, it should be between 15 and 18. Academically, they should be in the upper third of their class. They should be curious about other cultures. They should also be good ambassadors for Canada and our culture. And they also need to be open to change and new experiences.
And how are candidates, what kind of things are done to ensure the safety and well-being of the students?
Okay, sure. Well, I mean, obviously there are countries in the world where things are in turmoil, and so we don't exchange with those countries. Host families have to undergo a vetting program. They have to pass criminal background checks. The students spend about 6 months with Rotary before they go attending training conferences, and at those conferences they'll learn things like how to recognize when they're experiencing culture shock, how to deal with homesickness, that. And they'll also work with other exchange students who are here from the countries that they're going to be going to and help them learn, get ready for what life is going to be like in those countries.
So how are the kids matched with their foreign families?
Well, during the application process, the students have to choose the countries that they want to go to. Once they're assigned to a country, somebody goes to work, somebody, usually a youth exchange officer in a local Rotary club, like myself, and that person lines up those families in that community where they're going to live. Yeah.
But the families are very well known to you before anybody leaves Canada.
The students, usually it's the first person they, people they hear from before they go on exchange. A lot of times they'll get a little innocent email from their future host sister saying, hi, I'm not supposed to be talking to you yet, but I can't wait to meet you, that kind of thing. So.
Okay, well, let's talk to some of the participants. Okay, say your name and where you're going. And oh, you got the name tags
yes.
on. Okay, and you went to Angelica.
Yeah, I went to Croatia.
Okay.
I went to Germany.
And that's Laura.
I'm Abby, and I went to France.
I'm Jesse. I'm going to the Czech Republic.
And you're the nervous one because you haven't gone yet.
Yep.
Okay, let's have some questions. First, the ones who have completed the Rotary Exchange Program, what was the greatest thing you learned by going on it? Angelica?
You learn a lot about yourself, like some things that you didn't realize before. You go through a lot of things, so you get more patient. You just get a lot of life experience in 1 year.
As she said, because you learn so much about yourself, you know when you want to take more risks in a situation, you become a lot more open-minded.
I learned that you can eat a lot of things.
And Jess, you haven't learned yet.
You'll find out.
You'll find out. Okay, what was the most difficult part?
Coming home, because not just pins are falling everywhere on the plane, but reverse culture shock is extreme. Because you think you're going to come home and everything may not be the same, but you kind of expect it to be the same.
Same for you, or?
It was a bit different, actually. Integrating into the host families, not knowing what they expected from you, and not being able to communicate as well because you didn't speak the same language.
And did they speak your language?
They spoke a bit of English, but I could never understand my host father.
Okay. And Abby?
Going to school at 8 a.m. when you leave at 6:45 a.m. and then get home at around 8 o'clock p.m. That was a bit difficult.
Yeah, that's a long day for sure. What did you find the most unusual thing in the country you lived in?
Some of the superstitions. So one of them was if you sit on bare concrete, you could freeze your ovaries.
No danger with that with me.
I have a bit of a story, actually. So the first month I got there, my host family took me swimming. After we went swimming, I didn't expect this. They started to strip right in front of me to change, and I had to avert my eyes really quick.
Are you talking male and female?
Yes.
Okay. From what country? That was Germany, wasn't
yes,
it?
Yes, Germany.
Yeah. Okay, Abby?
I ate a pigeon heart. That was very unusual.
Okay. Jess, you listened to all this?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. What are your final comments about the Rotary Exchange Program?
If you get the chance to do it, I suggest you try, because I didn't think I was going to do it, and it was one of the best decisions I've ever made.
Obviously, you collect pins and things like that when you go. if they have them on one side, they'd be going like this.
It's the most rewarding experience I've had so far.
It's just amazing.
Just do it.
Abby lives across the road from me, and I didn't recognize her because when she came across, she said, what left was a very young woman, and what came back was an older woman, and your hairstyle was different, and I didn't recognize her at first because she'd sort of grown in many ways, and I'm sure you grew inside well as far as your confidence and things like this. So what are your expectations, Jess, going to the Czech Republic?
I don't really have any expectations. I have no idea what's going to be thrown at me, so...
And how long are you going to be staying there?
Until the beginning of July.
Beginning of July. And have you had any contact with your host family at all?
Yep, my host sister sneakily texted me on Facebook, and I talked to her, and me and her have FaceTimed, and she showed me her whole house, and I've seen pictures of her family, and we've talked a lot.
Okay, you talked a lot.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Mark, if people want to investigate about getting involved, what can they do?
Well, here in St. Mary's, we're always looking for host families. It's not the easiest thing to do. And right now we have a student arriving on Tuesday night from Taiwan. And I have his first and last host family, but I don't have his middle host family to host them from the middle of December through to the end of March. So
host families have them for how long?
About 3.5 months.
So they're here for 9 months.
No, 10, 11 months.
Okay, my math is not so great. Yeah.
If you know of a young person who you think would be interested in this program, we'd love to be put in touch with them. We think it's an excellent program. That being said, on Wednesday night this week, we begin earnestly interviewing four candidates who want to go on exchange next year. So if there's anybody out there that would like to throw their hat into this program, they need to do it pretty quick.
And how do they do that?
Contact me.
And how do they do that?
And I'll stay here behind the show after the show tonight to answer any questions. I've got cards with me.
Okay. So get a business card, and they can go to the Rotary Facebook site and get information or leave a message there?
Yep, or they can go to centralstatesrotaryyouthexchange.org. I've got all the information. Happy to help people.
Okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming in. Okay, we go to now to our next commercial. Don, what's it all about?
Well, you know, I was listening to Mark there. Mark, I just want to say, from the town of St. Mary's, thanks for putting on the program. It takes a big man to do all that work. It sounded so good. Frank is ready to sign up for Germany. He really liked the sound of that.
Oh, I'll be there.
Speaking of apologies, you and I have some apologies to make to our wives after 9 weeks of giving up our Sundays here. So what say maybe we go off to Lyric Flowers on Monday?
Good evening, St. Mary's, and around the world. I'm Landy Orr, and this is my business partner, Jay Harrison. We're the proud owners of Lyric Flowers here in downtown St. Mary's. Thank you. We've actually been open now 7 years. It'll be this November that we've been open. And this past weekend, we're pleased to announce we celebrated our 425th wedding since being open at our store. So if you feel like you need to have some apology flowers like these two gentlemen up here, or anniversary flowers, birthday flowers, whatever you're feeling the need for, feel free to come down and see us at 123 Queen Street East in St. Mary's here. We do have a quick draw that we're going to offer as well for a free bouquet that we just designed up. Ooh. Can anybody tell me the anniversary of our actually opening, that we when we were opened, first day open?
December
1885. Close enough. No, just yeah, I did say November. That is correct, Marie. November 25th is the answer. Or that's my mother that said that. So in lieu of the occasion, I'm going to actually invite Marie to come on up here. This is John's lovely wife.
Yeah.
And I'll present her with this lovely bouquet. Cheers. You're welcome, Marie.
Okay. Marie, does that get me off the hook?
Yes.
Oh, lovely.
Yes, I have to buy mine.
I'll share, Don. I'll share.
Where have all the flowers gone? Tulip, Lyric Flowers. Where have all the flowers gone? In St. Mary's. Where have all the flowers gone? Tonight they've gone to Marie, everyone. Oh, she'll never learn. But she's got flowers and Johnny, and he's got money to burn. Congratulations. Thank you, Lyric Flowers. Yeah, baby.
Okay. Thank you, Frankie. Baby.
Hey, I love you, baby.
It all started with a sock.
The end of the
rocketed
show.
Rocketed from there. Here to tell you everything you want to know about Pook products are Tony Pook and Kevin McCotter.
Pook, pook me. Pook, pook, pook me. Pook, pook. Pook me, pook, pook me.
Pook, pook me.
Have you copyrighted those lyrics?
Absolutely.
You just made that up, right?
I just made that up.
How do I know?
Pook me. What if I said to my wife, pook me? What would she say? Wear your hat?
This is a family show, right?
Maybe.
Yeah, it is. But not with Frank.
I don't know the difference.
Okay, first, let's destroy the alternate facts out there.
How did this all start? Come on close to the microphone. Then.
He's Tony Pook. He should tell the story of the Pook Toque, right?
Okay, go ahead.
Well, it's a simple story, John, really. I was socializing in an apartment, a small little apartment. You know that time in your life when you finish college or university, but you don't really have a job and no one wants to hire you, so you're just kind of fumbling through life, not really doing anything productive?
Mm-hmm.
It was during that time, and there was some libations, and a sock ended up on my head at one point. And I got a little bit of attention, and that kind of spawned the idea that it's possible to make socks wearable on your head. Really, that's it.
Okay. When did you get the idea that you were really onto a big thing?
I'll field that one. So from that night, Tony was with more of... I'm 3 years older than Tony. He grew up best buddies with my younger brother. Tony pitched all his friends, hey, why doesn't somebody help me make these sock hats and we'll sell some, and everyone just thought he was a bit of a goof. No, that's true.
Really?
And then we were just sitting in Bentley's in Stratford one night, and he's like, Kevin, you've done some business stuff. Can you help me? And I was like, all right. Because the first store he ever got into after his mom taught him how to sew the sock hats was Family and Company in Stratford.
Yeah.
And I said, okay. And then I put in, I don't know, a couple thousand bucks to make sock hats. And we did our first craft show out in Calgary. And it was this super vintage fancy craft show where people sell like jewelry for $500 a piece and stuff, and we had shipped a garbage bag of sock hats is all we had, and there were 400 sock hats, and we thought that would last us for like a month, and we literally sold out in the first day.
Wow.
And they were so mad at us at the craft show, the craft show owners, they're just like, because we weren't able to stay there and sell anything. And so we sold out the first day, and we just went, I think sock hats might work.
Got something here. Yeah. Okay. What was the most difficult thing in starting your business?
Working with Tony. You?
I would say working with Kevin. We are total polar opposites.
Yeah.
You know, like I enjoy the fruits of life, and I like colors and mountains and music and love, and I cherish things. And Kevin just doesn't like anything. He doesn't like anything at all.
You've got to be
There's not a single thing that he likes. So it's hard to get along with someone like that.
I'm even just curious, is there anybody out there who was there during the original night when this thing happened? You don't seem to have many friends.
Just her husband.
Oh, okay. Okay, very
Greg
good.
Greg Robson was there.
Okay.
He's a local.
What's the hardest thing you face now with your business?
Just deciding how big to get or how to get big. Mm-hmm. Or bigger.
The challenge is to keep coming up with new things, right? Eventually, everyone you know will have a sock hat, and then what's next, right?
Yeah.
So you always have to be on top of that and making new stuff and trying to think of something else that'll work, and so that's always a challenge.
Okay, so you were on Dragon's Den. Tell us about that.
The one thing about Dragon's Den that people should know is, like, basically none of those deals really even happen. It's
really?
All TV. Everyone's lying. It's all lies. The whole thing is a lie. Don't believe it. They cut it. They edit it. And I remember watching it, and I'm like, I didn't make that face after he said that. I know I didn't make that face. And so, and they're very good, they're very friendly, and they're asking about your family, and everyone's happy and laughing, and all of a sudden you watch the episode, and they're angry at you, and they're calling you crazy, and Kevin's crying at one point.
So it's sort of like fake news.
It's fake news.
Fake news.
Yeah. So okay. We got a deal with on the one time we were on there, and it didn't pan out, just like every other deal doesn't pan out. Very few of them do. But it's good television.
Yeah, but you got a good exposure of them, right?
Great, yeah, that was great exposure. It's really big for us, actually.
How you doing there, pal? Okay, so you started with the original product. How did you come up with the other ones? Because some are pretty crazy.
Have you met Tony Pook?
Actually,
This is the first time I've met him.
I would say we have good buddies who are always on the road with us doing these we call them Pook Toque tours. During the booth sales, you're logging hours and hours in a booth, and that's when you start thinking of new products, and people are asking you, why don't you make that? And you're like, well, I don't know, and then you make that, you know? Mm-hmm. So you're always getting people requesting stuff, and so that's part of it, for sure.
So how far can it go? Are you just finding out as you go along?
Space. Yeah, we're looking into launching a sock hat.
You think
outer space?
Canadian astronaut, and you know, Hatfield took up the guitar, right, and things like that. Maybe one of the space guys can go up with a Pook Toque.
Well, one of my good friends is Elon Musk, and we're talking about things.
Is this true?
No.
All lies.
Because I was hoping to maybe get Ellen here, you know? here's a question, because I used to work in sport in Canada, and should we be expected to see our athletes wearing Pook gear at the next Winter Olympic Games?
I would say no, but we got one of our first big breaks from just this really nice woman we met. We meet so many people doing like these shows. We met an amazing woman that worked for HBC, and she's like, why don't you come in and talk to us and stuff? And we thought all of a sudden we were going to be making Olympic gear, and Prince Harry was going to wear it at his wedding. But we ended up getting like an HBC deal where they did put us in a bunch of their stores, and so we were in HBC for a while, but you're competing against like Nike and Roots and all that sort of jazz. Mm-hmm. So, but we have had a lot of good breaks and met a lot of good people that have helped us.
Now tell me about some of the products you make. You make the Pook Toque. What else?
Well, Tony, I would suggest you stand up and show one of our newest.
Is there anything under there? This, by the way?
No.
John, that's an after-hours show. But this is our reversible faux fur lingerie robe bath coat. I think John was going, ooh, ah.
It's almost like P. Diddy and Hugh Hefner had a baby.
Okay, wonderful. And what else do you make?
Well, you know, an assortment of products, John. You know, we from sock mittens and you know, slippers with rubber grip on the bottom, so people won't slip and slide if they have a few cocktails at night. Mm-hmm. We have onesies with fully functional butt flaps. A onesie without a fully functional butt flap is a pointless piece of fabric.
Okay.
So throw in the garbage. You need a fully functional butt flap. Those are big. Baby sock hats and dog jackets and what else?
And we have dog booties. I think I saw a dog booty there.
Yeah, nice booty actually.
Those actually weren't dog booties. They were baby mitts, but I asked the woman to put them on the dog. People come up to us and they go, do you have any dog stuff? And we're like, yeah, just shove these on your dog's feet.
Here we go. Maybe the microphone is windsock. Yeah.
Well, that's what we call pookie dookie. But yeah, perfect for dog's feet.
Maybe you can make a dog waste picker upper called a Pookie Poopy.
I already thought of that.
How come he gets more laughter than I do? I don't understand. Okay, well, we want to put something on St. Mary's life for people in St. Mary's to come up with some new ideas. Here we go. I thought of, for Australia, a boomerang holder. I thought that would be good.
Don't want to deal with the time difference and operating over there.
Okay. Adam Wheel came up with a backpack that turns into a sleeping bag.
I totally suggest Adam Wheel starts up a company that builds backpacks that turns into, what, a sleeping wheel?
Sleeping bag, yeah. Courtney Luke suggested Pook Christmas stockings and blankets.
Courtney is right on the mark there. We actually have a new Pook blanket coming out soon. Faux fur. And no one's ever done plaid faux fur before. We're really excited about it. We were actually featured on Fabric Quarterly. Do you subscribe to that magazine?
Can't say I do.
It doesn't exist. Oh, okay. But if it did, we would be featured on it.
Okay. Ariana Polk, I think that's POCH, would like a plaid yoga mat bag.
Ariana?
Yeah. Now, you've been featured in Yoga Magazine too, right?
Well, I'm a yoga instructor.
Oh, okay.
I invented the dog down move.
Okay.
Also, we have yoga pants now. I'm not joking. They're sensational. They have a disintegrating plaid print and multiple pockets. And they're great for working out. Kevin's addicted to working out. I'm addicted to working out now. It's healthy, and they're sensational.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, we have those.
Okay, great. Now, you're men about town. You're from St. Mary's first, right? You grew up here.
I grew up about 200 feet up the hill, and I used to swim where everyone's sitting right now.
We've gone metric in this show.
Metric.
We've gone metric in this show.
Did I use
You said
some...
200 feet.
Oh, sorry.
How many meters?
Like one.
Okay. Okay. And where did you grow up?
Hey, went to St. Mike's.
I grew up something like 3 meters past Kevin's place.
And when did you meet him?
We met, I don't know, I can't even remember. I used to hang out here with his younger brother. I went to school with him, so the McCotters and the Pooks have always been family friends, so basically our whole life.
Okay, wonderful. And you're still friends?
Well, no, we never became friends. We actually kind of don't like each other at all.
Okay.
And that's one of the beauties of our relationship.
Now, one of you lives in New York, right?
Yeah, I live in New York now.
And where do you live?
Toronto.
Toronto. Yeah. But you come back? You came back exclusively for the Front Porch Show, didn't you?
Yes. How would you turn down Front Porch Show?
I don't know.
I live in Toronto, but I come back. Family's still here, and I love golfing at River Valley Golf Club.
River Valley Golf Club!
What have you learned about in life, the philosophical? We're going to get philosophical here, okay? You're into that? You can do this?
Yeah.
Okay. What have you learned about life in all this?
Just have fun.
Wow. That's so insightful.
Yes. Que sera, sera.
Yeah, pretty much.
Heavy, man. You know, on a serious note, one thing that I've learned is to hang out with people you don't like, and you know, just to go for it. So if you have an idea, and like time is so finite and life is short, and if you have an idea, just go for it and rip it, even if it's something as ridiculous as selling socks on your head.
Time is actually infinite.
All right, well, it's finite for a human being, so what I'm saying is just rip it, just go for it.
Just sort of like a Front Porch Show.
Exactly, yeah.
You just go for it.
There's no point in holding back on it, right? Yeah.
See what happens.
Lanny, good example. We grew up with Lanny, and he went and started his flower shop. He probably didn't know what was going to happen, and he's been a great success.
Yeah. Can you follow your dream?
Tony will probably tell you a story about his dream.
Actually, that's nice that you brought that up, following your dream. I remember when I was a little boy at Holy Name of Mary, Mrs. Ruppel was teaching me then, and Mrs. Ruppel told us to write down what we wanted to be when we grew up. And so, of course, the children wrote down what they wanted to be, and I had forgotten about this. And then my mother had been going through my memoirs box last month, and she found that piece of paper. And it said, sock hat salesman. So, ever since I was a little boy, I knew I wanted to be a sock hat salesman before I even knew what a sock hat was. So it's an example. If you follow your heart and never give up, you can accomplish anything. Never give up.
Very good. Okay. Thank you. We've really enjoyed having you in the show. You're always welcome here, and you may even do. By the way, our ads are free, so we're going to give you a free ad on next year's show. Costs nothing, and come on the show again next time you're in town. We'd love to have you. Okay.
Awesome. This is amazing to see in St. Mary's, and I think it's just a great event for the town. So good for you guys, everyone that does all this stuff too. Thanks for having us.
Hey, John, you know what I wanted to be when I grew up?
When you haven't grown up yet.
Well, there's that, but I wanted to be the MC to the Front Porch Show.
Yes.
It happened, ladies and gentlemen.
It happened. Anything can happen. Frank, what did you want to be when you grew up?
Well, I was going to say, if I pook you, would you pook me? If I pook you, would you pook me? If I pooked you, would you pook me? Pook.
You just made that up, right?
I just made that up.
Oh, I made that up.
If I pook you, would you pook me?
No.
I gotta say that.
I guess I'm out of a hat then, right?
Okay, well, we have our next commercial coming up, right, Don?
Yeah, you know, speaking of spicing things up, Frank.
Okay.
We got Troyer Spices with us again.
Whoa.
Spice me, baby. Spice me, baby. You're spiced up, go.
I don't know, Dan. What do you want for dinner?
Your chicken lasagna tastes really good.
Mm. Well, I could make that, but I think I'm all out of, you know, my secret ingredient.
Well, doesn't your grocery store have that?
In town? No. No, they don't have that, but I think Troyer Spices does, and I just need a tablespoon.
So whether you need a tablespoon or more, Troyer Spices has the variety and what you need to make your next meal memorable.
Whether it's a single spice or a salt-free blend, come on out to Troyer Spices at 110 Queen Street East. Make our spices work for you.
Troyer Spices.
Better prices.
Fresher spices.
Okay, I'm one of the producers of the show, but Rob Edney is one of the other producers of the show. Come on, Rob. We've had a couple of requests because people really don't know why we did this, and sometimes we don't. But we want to answer some of your questions about the Front Porch Show. So one of the questions we often get is, how did this start?
So John and I served on a few committees together, and we'd done some work in town. And the thing I really connected with John over was that John is the guy that will throw all the ideas out there, no matter how crazy they sound. And one of the ideas that happened many years ago was he said, I want to do a talk show that promotes the people of St. Mary's, and everyone comes on and tells their story. And I thought, oh, that's a great idea, John, and then we kind of left it for a while.
Yeah. So next stage was MC at Rob's wedding, and good old Frank StGermain was over there.
It was our
sort of non-Front Porch Show, Front Porch Show, and I got to know Frank really well, and we sort of got along together. And then what happened was Marie and I were going to Costa Rica on Christmas Day, and we said, who in the world would give us a ride to the airport on Christmas Day? Well, we decided to see if Rob would, and he did. And while we were on the way, Marie said, okay, tell Rob about your idea. And I did, and he remembered it. And he said, oh, yeah, we should do that. And I kept on saying, rrr. And so finally, about 3 months later, because Marie had heard this about 3 years, she said, John, I'm tired of hearing about this idea. Do it. Not do it. You are going to do it. So I had to do it, and I did it. And one of the questions they asked was, well, how did you get to be MC? Well, it was my front porch. I guess that's one thing. But no, the honest truth is, if this was going to fail and somebody was going to look bad, it was going to be me. Because I didn't want anybody else. It's a small town, and when you're in a small town, if somebody falls flat in their face, I didn't want somebody falling flat in their face on my idea. So it was my idea, fell flat in my face, it was me. But then we had to get good people.
Well, and one of the things I liked was we reached out to people we knew. We reached out to people we knew who had certain capabilities. And so I guess what we can quickly do here is talk about each of the individuals who did that. But the funniest thing is I think every single person we reached out to and told this crazy idea to, and when I say crazy, I look out here and I see 312 people sitting here. Pretty crazy, isn't it? So anyway, over the last 2 years, it's come to define our Sunday nights in the summer, and it's been absolutely amazing. But if we could just take a second, one of the funny things was that every person we reached out to said, including Frank, said, I'll help you with the first show. But then, you know, after that,
maybe two. Maggie said two,
yeah. But you know what? We've had the same staff the entire time, and it's been amazing how each person came on. So maybe we can kind of talk about each one. I want to introduce Joseph Flynn first. This is Joseph Flynn here. Stand up and say hi. So just quickly, Joseph came to us in show number one. We couldn't get a musical guest. We had Frank, and we needed a musical guest. And so it was summer, and I reached out to some of the bands in the store, and I ended up getting a bunch of 8-year-olds to come on and play I Love Rock and Roll. But knowing that I had to do other things, I needed Joseph to help out. And Joseph is so effective and made everything work that he came back for the next show.
One guy who I conned into doing the first year and helped an awful lot was John Dizer. But he said, you know, he really wanted to spend time with his family on Sundays. And he was really, really kind in helping us through as audio for most of the first year. And the audio equipment in the beginning, we got to thank the town. They've got all this audio equipment for us. But the first year, I don't know if the Presbyterian Church knows, but we used to raid the church. And we had about 5 different sources for our audio. We just plug it together, throw it together, then take it back in the night, in the dark of night, and that was it. So we have a lot of people. Maggie came on as floor director. Jeff was there, and Jeff came on, and Jeff Coverley, and Maggie Whitcroft, and they really helped. Fern, I think Maggie, you recruited Fern, didn't you? Because Fern said, and Fern's been the videographer for almost every show, so that's really good.
And then, Peter McCash came in. I believe Peter. Yeah, he came just to watch a show. He just came to watch a show and started taking pictures. And I think we were looking, going, "Are you doing a selfie right now?"
No.
Oh, nice. See, this is what I'm talking about. So Peter started taking these pictures and posting them on our site, and we're like, "Wow, Peter takes a pretty damn good picture." And he became the official photographer. So thank you, Peter McCash.
No, he's not the official. He's the official unofficial photographer, because he basically said, I don't want to be part of this, but I want to be part of this. So he's sort of on the edge. He's sort of there. Okay, Marie, by the way, my wife Marie, she was community calendar last year. Marie just picks up where everybody can't do something. Fern couldn't do it, do camera one show, and in the next show we had an incident and couldn't do the camera for the other show. And Marie just steps right in, and if we're short of anything, there's Marie. And she just says, now... Don. Oh, you're Don. Well, Don plays tennis with me and stuff like that, so Don didn't have any choice, so...
Sure enough. How's that hand there, John?
Yeah, he almost broke my wrist.
What, John, I'm going to answer this after you. I'm going to ask you the question. You can answer me the question. What was your favorite memory so far?
Christmas show was really fun.
You took my answer.
Oh, yeah. The Christmas show was wild. We didn't know what was happening. We had a donkey coming in, and funny story is that the donkey was supposed to come down, and they had a carrot to try to get the donkey to come down. So the people who were doing the carrot thing, they decided to try to see if it worked. Well, the donkey went hump and just ate the whole carrot right there, so they had nothing to tempt the donkey. So I said to them, I said, as soon as I get out there, I got nothing to say, bring the donkey in. And so what happened was is that I'm standing up there, and it's all dark beyond them, and I have no idea where the donkey is. And I almost said, get your ass down here. But
but we can't say that on
But we can't
TV.
Say that on the Front Porch Show.
Frank can, though.
And of course, Rob was in it from the start. You know, from that trip to the airport, he was convinced that I said, okay, you said do it. You got to do it. Who else? Are we missing anybody? I was afraid of missing anybody.
Frank
came on. Well, we worked at it, did Y, and he helped with one show. But here's an amazing man. Not only did he become the music director, which I don't know what that means, Frank.
I don't either.
But that's okay. But we love each other very much. He's just one of the great friends I've had in my life. But I just said, okay, well, when you come on the first show, just sort of play something. And when we go off at the end, just sort of play something. Well, the next show he comes, and he's composed, Hello, Hello.
The Front Porch Show.
And it's amazing. And then by the third show, he's composed Home St. Mary's, which has become, I believe, the official anthem of this town. It's a beautiful song. Okay, so that's... Oriana. We got Oriana in now.
Yeah.
We've sucked her in.
Cher.
Yeah, well, Cher, we've got her in. You're now in it, right? Sure. So we'll be looking at you. If you want to become involved in this show, this isn't about me, it's not about Rob, it's all about St. Mary's, but if you want to become involved, just come to us and invent a position. You say, because that's what Peter did.
He invented a position. We're glad to have you.
Yeah.
Okay, and there we go.
If you've got, we're looking forward to season three. If you've got any ideas for us, we're more than willing to hear those ideas. And we just talked about quickly why the show works. And I think the show works because we get to hold up this mirror to the community and show you absolutely how beautiful this community is. And it's a simple mirror. All we are is a mirror saying, look, this is what you are. This is who you are. And each of you come up here and tell your story. And each week I'm absolutely blown away by the amazing people that live next door to me.
Yeah. You know? And we probably got next year's shows probably about half full of people who have just, we didn't know they were here. And all of a sudden, like, for example, the one guest we had is, she was last year, nanny to the royal family and to the author Daniel Steele. 3 weeks prior to this show, we had no idea she even existed. And here she was, she just lived down the street from us. So these are the kind of people who live in St. Mary's, and they're kind enough to donate their time because absolutely nobody gets paid. This is all giving back to your community, and we thank you for that. Okay, well, we got to get on here because we got an amazing choir. I've wanted to have them on the show for a long, long time. And I think it's very fitting that they are on our last show. We had a great band on our first show. We have a great choir on our last show. Here they are, the Stonetown Entertainers.
Yeah.
was beautiful. Very, very nice. Okay, I'm here with Dave Ride, and he's the spokesperson for the group. We want to hear more of your music, but I have a few brief questions. First, how long has the choir been going?
It's been together longer than 40 years now. I think 42 years.
Right. And how many people are in it?
Nominally, about 25.
Right.
Yep.
You have almost everybody here tonight, then. That's great.
We've got two-thirds of the choir here.
That's great. Well, yep. Wonderful. Is there any age restriction?
You have to be 55. It is a seniors choir. After that, anybody and everybody's welcome.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like a lot of fun. Are you looking for specific voices for the coming year?
We could use some more men, please. Men. Some basses and tenors. And sopranos and altos are always welcome.
So everybody's pretty well welcome.
Absolutely.
And there's no size restriction, right?
No.
What about a belly? Somebody says, I can't sing.
Come and put a smile on, be a pretty face, and make a joyful noise.
Okay, wonderful. Well, look, I'm not going to talk much more because I want to hear you sing some more. You're going to do two more songs, but first, before I do that, how do you join?
You join by first joining the Friendship Center, and then there is a choir membership as well. Our first practice this year is September 20th. So come on out to the Friendship Center, join the Friendship Center, and join the choir.
And what's the commitment towards the choir?
Come out as often as you can. We'll do between 6 and 8 sing-outs in the season. We'll be singing at the Christmas lunch over at the Friendship Center again.
Well, we're really glad that one of your sing-outs has been the Front Porch Show. Thank you very much. Let's hear what you got to offer now.
Yep.
In the quiet, misty morning, when the moon has gone to bed, when the sparrows stop their singing, and the sky is clear and red, when the summer ceases gleaming, when the corn is past its prime, when adventure's lost its meaning, I'll be homeward bound in time. I'll be gone through the pasture, chain me not to the bough, set me free to find my calling. Thank you.
Thank you. Our first song was Flying Free by Dawn Bessig. Second one was one of our favorites, Homeward Bound. And now we'll sing a song that Lanny arranged for us, Shenandoah.
Shenandoah, I long to hear you away, you rolling river.
Oh, Shenandoah, I long to hear you away. Found a way across the wide Missouri.
Oh, Shenandoah, Shenandoah, I love your daughter.
Okay, thank you very much, and Lanny, thank you, Lanny Hoare, for directing the choir. Is that your official choir title? Choir director? Choir?
That works.
Yeah. That works, okay. We live in St. Mary's, everything works. Okay, well, that's it for the summer season for the Front Porch Show, and thank you for coming to Cadzow Park and watching on the internet. A few thank yous for making this night really special from 6 to 7. Stonetown Coffee provided coffee and goodies. Canadian Baseball Hall of Fame, the burgers and hot dogs and stuff. Obviously, we have to thank the Pooks for all their Pook gear, River Valley for some of the wonderful prizes, and also St. Mary's Ford and the Salvation Army for providing the truck for our food bank. Hopefully, if you haven't given food to the food bank, they are in need of food, so try to drop it off sometime this week, okay? Now, we'd also like to thank our guests, Gail McCauley, Matthew Corbett, Mark Oliver with Abby Lighton, Laura Vink, Angelica Pierce, and Jesse Lawson. The Pook Toque guys, Kevin McCotter and Tony Pook. And our musical guests, the Stonetown Entertainers. We won't be here next Sunday, but put November 25th in your calendar. That's when we're going to have our Christmas special. And yes, it will be outdoors no matter what the weather. Why? Because we are Canadian. And we do all this kind of crazy stuff. And we hope, we'll see, that Ellen may be here. Who knows? We'd also like to thank all those who have helped us financially this year. And there's still time if you want to help, just approach us quietly and we'll do something. The Town of St. Mary's for providing the audio equipment and the venue here. The Rotary Club for supplying our iPod camera, that was great. McBride's Rentals for the black curtains. And the Salvation Army for helping me look so good every week. So good night, everyone. See you on November 21st. No, November 25th. There we go. Frank, take us home.
Well, thank you. How about a nice hand for John Stevens and the whole staff here? I know we're running a little overtime, but here's the good news. The good news is we've completed our second season. Again, when John first asked me to do this last year, I said, yeah, right. But, you know, it becomes sort of something that, you know, when people come up to me and say, hello. I think, yeah, the Front Porch Show. Great. So I know it's getting late for you guys, too, and Monday is another day. I'm going to say that my little granddaughter here right now, the reason why I say that, she's raised $150 off her lemonade stand for the hospital for St. Mary's, okay? Her name is Addison Down, and she's a really cool, what I call her is a really cool chick.
Get that right, Eddie. Okay, we're going to get everybody hopefully singing the song. You guys know it?
Yeah.
You do?
How's it going?
I was born in Ontario, a place to stand, a place to grow. From Pickle Lake to Point Pelee, there's no place I'd rather be than my hometown they call Stonetown, the prettiest town for miles around. Little falls laugh and people share smiles, they treat you like family
before the mosquitoes come. Go!
St. Mary's home to me. Oh, St. Mary's home to me. Can't the time I've been amazed. How I've been blessed, how God has great. How it's led to this special place. Quite a mystery, where anyone can be a friend. And farmers' fields, they never end. And through it all flows the mighty Thames. What a sight to see.
Woo! Come on, everybody.
Home, St. Mary's home to me. Oh, St. Mary's home to me.
A little louder.
Behind me many miles on old highways, on dusty trails. When times got rough, when all else failed, I knew where I should be. Back in my hometown, they call Stonetown, prettiest town for miles around. Little false light, people share smiles, they sing in harmony.
Bring the roof down over the sky. Go!
St. Mary's home to me. Oh, St. Mary's home to me.
Everybody.
St. Mary's home to me.
Let's try it, John, together.
Home, St. Mary's. St. Mary's.
home, St. Mary's, St. Mary's home to me.
Stand up, it's okay.
Home, St. Mary's, St. Mary's home to me.
Oh,
home, St. Mary's, St. Mary's home to me.
Come on.
Home, St. Mary's, St. Mary's home to me. It's my home, St. Mary's, St. Mary's home to me. It's my home, St. Mary's, St. Mary's home to me. It's my home, St. Mary's.
Ain't that right, Johnny?
You got it.
Get over here with me.
St. Mary's home.
Love you, baby.
To me.
Thank you for watching the Front Porch Show. See you on our Christmas special, November 25th.